Broadway, Broadway, in all of its glory, we all have a memory, we all have a story. Was there an understudy, or did the show stop? Did you see Barbara before she shot to the top? Join us as we revel in a reverie, it's my Broadway memory.
Hi!
Hello!
What's up, Brian? Welcome, everyone, to My Broadway Memory.
We're your hosts. I'm Brian Sedita.
I'm Michael Kushner. I'm so glad everyone's here.
So happy, and we're so excited for tonight's guests and all the exciting things we have planned for tonight.
Brian, it looks like you're in a new place.
I am. Stan and I just moved into our new house, so I tried to get this room a little bit ready because I knew that people would be watching it, but I got a little bookcase to finally put all my Playbill binders. They're all in those little boxes, and that's a flying monkey right there.
Because you love, I think there's someone.
Everyone needs a flying monkey.
I can't believe in this chat alone, there's more than one person that loves Wicked. That loves Wicked more than me. That's what I'm trying to say. It's like actually insane.
You love it. We'll be putting lots of posters on the wall, I'm sure. Sure, this one will get on there because this is a very exciting one for me.
Oh, OBC.
Yeah.
We have a guest that was in the show, so we can pick her brain about that. But I'm so excited. I love Thursdays.
How was your week?
It was good. It was good. The studio is back open, like I keep saying, I guess. It just every day it feels so exciting and fresh and new because I'm like, oh my God, people. But there's Halloween candy in the house, so that's really good.
We saw candy corn on the shelves, and it was like a huge bag. And Stan was like, do you want candy corn? I'm like, yeah, but not that much. It's like, I can only have one. I like candy corn, but only one. Oh, do you like candy corn?
Oh, I'll take it all. I'll take it all. Yeah, okay. I'll fully take it all. And just like the chocolate, the candy corn, the, you know, whatever. So I'm just, you know, I'm a Halloween fiend, but I won't start October 1st. I won't start until October 1st with Hocus Pocus. Once October 1st hits, that's when Hocus Pocus starts playing on a loop. On a loop.
Disney Plus.
On Disney Plus, I know, which we love. Should we get the show started?
Let's do it.
Let's do it. But before we get started, everyone, remember, we love hearing from you during the show. So feel free to make yourself known. You can ask questions and share stories.
Yes. And your comments and questions may even make it on the screen.
Also, we know we may have some new viewers watching, so please follow us on social media because we love interacting with you.
Yes, we do. That's at My Broadway Memory on Instagram and Facebook, and at My B-Way Memory on Twitter.
We're so excited for the show tonight. We're also adding a new segment.
I'm excited for that.
I know. And I really can't wait to do that. I'm so excited.
Does it have to do with Broadway back in the day?
Brian, don't give it away.
What's it called?
It's called Throwback Thursday.
Perfect. It's Thursday.
Yes, it is. We are literal Broadway TBT. Why don't you introduce the first guest?
Sounds great. Our first guest is Mary Testa. She was recently nominated for a Tony Award for her performance as Aunt Eller in the 2019 Broadway revival of Oklahoma. She's been seen on Broadway in Wicked, Guys and Dolls, Xanadu, Chicago, 42nd Street, Marie Christine, On the Town, Forum, The Rink, Marilyn and Barnum. Off-Broadway includes Portuguese Kid, Government Inspector, First Daughter Suite, Queen of the Mist, See What I Want to See, and A New Brain. Many film and television.
Much
film, much television. 12 original cast albums, multiple Tony, Lucille Lortel, Drama Desk, Drama League nominations, and a special Drama Desk Award celebrating 3 decades of outstanding work.
And I have the absolute pleasure of introducing comedic genius Jackie Hoffman, who was recently Emmy nominated for her performance in FX's Feud. Some select TV film credits include Gilmore Girls, Difficult People, Elementary, Girls, Inside Amy Schumer, Birdman, Garden State, Legally Blonde 2, Kissing Jessica Stein. And Broadway credits include Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, On the Town, The Addams Family, Xanadu, and Hairspray, in which she won a Theater World Award. And off-Broadway, she was recently seen in Fiddler on the Roof in Yiddish, Once Upon a Mattress, A Hanukkah Carol, The Book of Liz, which she got an Obie Award for, and you could check out her CD of her Jackie Hoffman Live at Joe's Pub.
Please welcome Mary Testa
and Jackie Hoffman. Hi!
Hello!
Oh,
my gay ass is geeking out, let me tell you. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you and welcome.
Thank you for having us.
Oh my gosh, I'm so thrilled that you're here.
And Happy New Year, Michael.
Yes, Shana Tova Feldshah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, Shana Tova. I was anticipating that there was going to be some Yiddish happening on this show tonight, and maybe we can give the children some a lesson of, you know, gay kocken off and yum, at least to start out with.
Oh, very good. And the first word was gay.
Yeah, well, it's perfect because here we are. Your hosts are exactly that. Gay kocken off and yum, for those that are watching, is go shit in the ocean in Yiddish. So
poetic language.
Well, that's very apropos.
I like that.
Poetic and beautiful.
I'll get on that.
And right, I know. It's kind of like the first thing you learn in Yiddish. It's like hello, goodbye, gay kocken off and yum.
You got the curses are up there.
The curses are up there.
It goes in one ear and out the other. I can't even say it back to you. It just goes so fast.
Gay.
Wow.
Gay.
Cockin.
Off.
And yum.
Gay cockin off and yum.
There you go. We're all Jewish Yiddish.
I think he's got it.
I played Colonel Pickering when I was 11 years old.
Uh-huh.
Just letting you know.
I loved while we were reading both of your bios that you both did On the Town, but in different times.
Yeah.
That was very interesting.
One of us was Tony nominated.
Oh.
Oh, well.
Oh, well.
We'll catch up some other time. We have a comment from Michael. Never forget when I saw Jackie after Xanadu on Broadway, and I said, I'm so happy watching you perform. You make me so happy to be gay. And she said, well, honey lamb, you are my people. Best night ever.
Aww. Oh.
That's amazing. Do you guys have stories like that where
did you guys meet during Xanadu, or how did you guys meet?
No, didn't we
do like Douglas Carter being Free to Be You and Me, a concert at the drama department? Wasn't that the first thing we did together?
I'm not sure, but we knew each other from auditions
forever. And, yeah.
Yeah. For a long time.
She's legend. She's legend.
Sweet. But
do you guys go for it?
What?
No.
I don't know where I'm supposed to look so that I'm in straight ahead. It doesn't seem that I have that option.
There's a camera.
You can look at your camera.
Yeah. Yeah.
Am I straight ahead now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Then I can't see everybody because I'm looking at the camera.
What makes you most comfortable.
Yeah, I'm just going to do this.
I wanted to know if you guys remembered what your tracks were in Free to Be You and Me.
It was a concert thing.
Yeah, we sat
on two stools. That was our track, but we had the opening number.
We did.
Yes, there's a land that I see where the true, and it was right on my break. So I'm like, there's a land, and Mary's like, ah!
I don't remember at all. I don't remember anything.
That's amazing. I feel like Mary could have been like Atalanta or like a doll. William has a doll. I grew up on Free to Be You and Me. I did not the other kids my age, but I fully did. So I love.
Well, you were different because you had a different interest.
Yes. Very. If Mel Brooks was in it, then I was watching it.
Right.
And he was. he was in it. So why don't we get started with the program, with the show?
Sure. So I've got a binder. Michael and I have them nice and organized in like little binders, our Playbill collections. So we're just going to flip to a random show.
Okay.
What's this one?
That's an ad, and it's gorgeous.
That is that one.
Don't do that one because you.
No, we'll do this one. This is in the Heights.
In the Heights.
Oh, this is exciting. So Actually, I was so excited to see this because I think, let's see, I saw this in January 2010. I do still have the ticket stub in here. Oh, this is pretty cool. When we walked in, they had little slips. Somebody was doing a cameo performance. I'm guessing they like
who
won.
Is that? Who was it?
Rick Weaver. I'm honestly guessing they won some sort of Broadway Cares like auction and they got a cameo. And then we had a lot of understudies on that day. And I knew that I was so excited to see, like, I was so excited to see Mandy Gonzalez and Lynn, or if he was still in, Javier was on that day. And Mandy was out. So that I was a little disappointed at that. But everybody was awesome. I remember I went with my uncle. He got me tickets for my birthday. And we got like third row orchestra. So it was really cool. And the Richard Rodgers has, I think, some of the best sight lines. I mean, no matter where you sit, I think you're getting a great view because of the, you know, the orchestra's on like a rake, the audience. Did anybody else see this one?
I did.
When it was on Broadway?
We did.
In fact, it obviously won the Tony against Xanadu and took away our only hope. And
they were
the queens in the audience on stage at Xanadu. I went up to them after they won, and it was the show after they won. And I shook someone violently in the audience and said, "The Dominican stole our Tony!" and he like left. I like scared the shit out of him.
I saw they must have given us tickets. Did they give us tickets? Because if
I think some of us saw it together, didn't we?
We had like the third balcony, and I couldn't understand a word anybody was saying. Not a word anybody was saying. And at the second act, I moved down, and then I could hear everything.
Well, at least you know that Vanessa didn't go to, she got out of college, right? When does that happen? Act two, act one? Yeah. I don't know, but.
Well, I mean, that's like probably the first time we heard music that fast, other than like patter songs, you know?
I enjoyed it. I thought it was staged beautifully. And by the time I got down to the second act, I could hear it. So I could understand what was going on.
That, and then do you speak Spanish?
No.
There's that too.
And there's that. But you know,
Ay, Karina, it is so hot.
You know, I don't have to have them speak English all the time. I can get the gist of what's happening.
Let's see. If I go to the back of the Playbill, I'm going to say some of the.
It's a little like Cats
playing
in
at
that
the time.
Way.
Oh, you were right across the street, Jackie. The Addams Family was playing at the time that I saw this. South Pacific, Rock of Ages, Little Night Music. View from the Bridge with Scarlett Johansson. Jersey
Boys. What
year was this? I saw this in 2010, but yes, it did come out in 2008.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I did. I saw Addams Family, and I the curtain opened and I cried because it was so, that tableau.
Yeah.
First of all, that overture is so cool. Whatever Lipa did with that. And that like screwing sound. I don't know what it is, but it's like. So cool. And then the tableau of all of the characters that we've known for years, you're all just standing in front of us in that, with that set and that music. It was, that is a visual I will never, ever forget. I love it.
It went downhill from there.
The night I saw it, Jackie was hilarious. I mean, Jackie's always hilarious. But you did a couple of extra things for me because I was in the audience. Right?
I think you did.
Yeah.
I love that. It's so funny. Both of your careers are like ones that the roles that you have played are iconic. I would do anything to have your careers like.
Yeah, very sweet. Well, all you have to do is just stay in it. You know what I mean?
Yes.
It's just about persistence. And perseverance. That's what it is.
Mainly, I do just want to play Madame Dilly, but you know, that's that's kind of all it is. I just
Madame
want to
play Dilly is fun.
Yes. Okay. So now we have one of you guys scheduled to do to share a specific memory or a playbill. So who did we have next? Who did we have? We had Mary. Would you like to share a specific story, or should we ask you something?
Because I think you need to ask me something.
Okay. Okay. Can you, because it was so recent and it took Broadway by storm, I would love to know a little bit of the process for Oklahoma, because it was so incredibly different than anything before. And I just want to know, and I think a lot of people would want to know sort of the process for that.
Yeah. And if, you know, if the deconstruction part of it was in the room, or if a lot of it was done outside of the room and brought to the company.
No, it was in the room. But it was a long process because it started like 5 or 6 years ago. We worked around a table at New York Theater Workshop for a couple of weeks, just looking at the script, just making sense of the script. And then we went up to Bard and we did a very successful run, sold out run up there. And then it took 4 years between Bard and St. Anne's. And then after St. Anne's, we closed in like November 2 years ago. And then we started rehearsals in January, February for Broadway. But the thing about, see, I'm not sure about deconstruction, but all the director wanted was that it was truthful and that it made sense. So, and it,
I guess stripped down is more of a better, yeah.
Yeah, there wasn't going to be big production numbers. There was just going to be the numbers. But anyway, that was the process. I don't want to take a lot of time talking about Oklahoma, but that was the process. And I was thrilled to be part of it and very proud of it. And I loved doing it.
I'm interested to know, what was the first Broadway show that you saw and when Pippin. That was?
Pippin. I was in high school. I think I was in high school and I saw Pippin. And I'll never forget Irene Ryan and what's his name? Ben
Vereen.
Vereen and the guy who played John Rubenstein. It was really good. I thought it was great.
Well, you saw the original cast. I did. Love that.
That's so cool.
I was younger than...
Now, there's a rumor that Irene Ryan, the rumor is that she died on stage doing the show.
Really?
What?
Because she doing had Pippin? She had a heart attack in the middle of No Time at All.
Wow.
That's what I know. Now, I don't think she kicked the bucket on stage. I think she finished the number and died in the wings.
Wow.
Oh my wow. God. That's
how I don't want to go.
I know, right? Especially as after a single.
He wasn't even on the screen. She had a heart attack.
When I saw her, she was alive. So there you go.
Yeah, she finished the show that day.
Yeah.
Well, I'm.
It was theater accessible for you? Where did you both grow up? Was theater something that you were, or Broadway something you were able to get to often?
Not me, Jackie.
I grew up in Long Island, so my parent, you know, I owe it all to my late parents. They took me to everything. I got to see everything, original casts of like in the heyday, you know, Chicago and Annie and Chorus Line.
Any of those shows, something that like looking back, you're like, wow, I saw those people doing that.
Yeah, like those three, everything I saw, I'm like, I saw those people doing that. Amazing. I mean, original. Yeah. Original form Chicago with Gwen and Cheetah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I would have loved to see that production. And I'm glad that in Fosse Verde they showcased that a little bit, because I think that many people think the 96 revival of Chicago is the production, but it had a whole life before it.
And God,
You
the
know,
96
I think,
production is the stripped down production. That's
yes,
right.
You know,
and Mary was in that also.
I was in that as well. I was Mama Morton number 823, I think.
Well, I'm glad they got to you, because I'm sure you were a perfect, perfect one.
It's the easiest thing in the world, that part.
Oh, I'm sure. Now, there's something that we talked about that you loved, and that was Queen of the Mist, and I'm kicking myself for not seeing that, because I think it was when I was in college and I didn't make it to the city much.
He was in college, Mary.
I know.
I don't want to tell you where I was.
Yeah, Brian's a lot younger than me, so.
So yeah.
No, I wanted
in utero.
I want people watching this to go and download the cast album. So
where was it? Was it on Broadway?
No, it was off Broadway. It was at Judson Gym. It was the Judson Church, and
historic.
Yeah, it's funny. I was just talking about it today because I had an interview this morning with people in London, and they asked me about Queen of the Mist, and so it's a Queen of the Mist kind of day. It was beautiful show that was written for me. Transport Group, Jack Cummings directed it. Michael John Lacusa wrote it, and it was a beautiful experience. It was challenging and a gorgeous experience. And I can't hear any of it without crying. I always start to cry.
It was just Remy and I kind of went down a little. I almost said K-hole. We went down a little spiral of watching you guys on YouTube and just sort of go And one of the videos that we came across was you recording the Queen of the Mist cast album. And I loved watching you do that. And those behind the scenes, you know, feel seeing Tally Sessions and Julie Murney with you. Yeah. It just seemed like it was an amazing experience. And I'm really, really sorry
for missing it. I was very grateful because we didn't do the album until 2 weeks after we closed. And it was a very, it was a lot. And so by the time we were closing, I was really tired and vocally really tired. And so I had 2 weeks to rest. So I was able to do the album with no, I was able to just, you know, kill it in a way because I had rest. So it was great.
Question for you regarding Queen of the Mist. And I sort of ask this whenever I chat with people that are playing someone that has existed that is no longer with us. But did, oh my God, now her name is escaping me, but did, your character's name?
Anna Edson Taylor.
Anna Edson Taylor. Did she ever visit you in a spiritual way? Did she ever show herself or make herself known?
No. No, she didn't. But the spirit of her brilliance and her difficultness and all that sort of lives in me. So I feel, I feel like, yeah, okay. You know, she was probably very pleased.
There is greatness in you.
Yeah. I love that. In all of us. Yeah. In all of us. That's the thing about it. But yeah. Yeah. Thanks for asking.
Of course. I find that to be really interesting. And, you know, as performers, as artists, you know, we are a very spiritual people. And we have these magical, Patty wrote in her book about Ava Perone visiting her. And you never know. There might be a sign. And so thank you for sharing that.
For asking. I wish she did. I mean, maybe she did. And I was too involved in trying to figure stuff out that I didn't realize it. I mean, it'd be nice to think about, but
I think if you felt her, if you just felt that presence and she was there, I think that's,
I have her picture on my piano and I will always have that picture when she came out of the barrel. Michael John gave it to me as an opening night present. It's her just coming out of the barrel. So I will always have that picture.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah. Before we get to Jackie's memory, and we do have some games planned, I think it's time for some good news. So Jackie and Mary, we're going to send you guys on a little Equity 5 while we bring on our good news correspondent. That's, you'd have to provide that.
Yes. Good news. Look behind you.
Yeah. We're going to bring on a good news correspondent, and we'll see you guys in a few minutes. We'll be right back. So here's some good news.
I love good news, and we need it more than ever. With school schedules wackadoo, studying theater has been thrown off. So I'm so excited to bring on Dawn Pierce, my vocal professor from Ithaca College, who is a part of How to Sing with Great Courses Plus.
Dawn Pierce is an assistant professor of voice at Ithaca College. She earned a Master of Music in Opera Performance from the University of North Carolina School of the Arts, where she also obtained a postgraduate professional artist diploma. She abounds with experience in a wide variety of styles and venues, performing in operas, musicals, concerts, and solo recitals. Praised as both an exceptional performer and an empowering teacher, she is devoted to teaching healthy vocal technique and promoting a deeper understanding of artistry and self-expression.
Please welcome the very wonderful Dawn Pierce. Hi!
Welcome!
Oh, It's so
Are you having fun? Are you watching
I'm
from backstage?
I'm having so much fun that I almost forgot that I had to talk to you because they're so funny and your show is so great and so fun. So thank you for including me.
Every episode, it takes me a second to like calm down because, as you know me, I'm just like in the presence of like greatness. So and I'm like geeking out. You know me, so. Just like calm down and settle, like have my thinking cap on and all that good stuff. So I'm so glad you're here. It's so great to see you.
So what brings you on here today, Dawn? What's the good news that you have to share?
Well, I just recently released my course with the company, The Great Courses. It's called How to Sing. And it's a course that I designed actually over the past 3 years. And it just came to fruition during this time. And, you know, who knew how important it was going to be? You were just talking about how artists are spiritual people, Michael. And I heard that and I was like, yes, that's how this project came to be for me. I actually received an email and I thought it was spam. I really thought it was spam. It was someone saying, we're from The Great Courses and we're interested in talking to you about you making a course about how to sing a digital version of a voice class. And I thought, right. Okay. And I don't know what it was that sparked my interest just enough that I just wrote a one line response that just said, tell me more about this, because I just really thought it was spam. And, you know, 3 years later and many, many visits of them coming to campus and watching me and phone interviews and them flying me there and me writing sample scripts and these things, I worked with them to create this resource. And so it was released during this pandemic and they actually bumped up the release to serve people in the pandemic that were really hungry for working on their art and working on their artistry. And you know, you would think it would be the opposite because they were shut down too, but they were able to really just come together and bring it out.
So how has delivering voice remotely helped the world and your students during COVID-19?
You know, it's really interesting because it has helped it in so many ways that I didn't anticipate. When I created this, I had no idea that we were going to be living in these COVID times. And so what was amazing about that is I didn't have the stress of having to create remote content. It was a choice I made. It was something I was passionate about and I was able to prepare for and think about. How do I deliver content to people I haven't met? Mm-hmm. How do I do this on the internet? And so, and how to, even this, you know, communicating with a camera and talking to people that I'm teaching how to sing, you know? And so, and then I was able to have a full production team to support that work. Mm-hmm. And all of these writers and people that really were passionate about creating this awesome product. And so when it was released, I had anticipated that people would take this course that loved to sing, but maybe were a little bit shy about taking lessons with someone for the first time, or maybe someone that had taken lessons at one point and wanted to pick it up again. Those were the people I was kind of thinking about of who might want to take the course. But I designed it intentionally as a challenge to myself to try to be for everyone. So someone who is really accomplished, that is on Broadway, or that is at a very high level singing, and then someone who's never taken a lesson in their life, which is a little bit crazy, but that was my goal. And what has happened is that people around the world have been contacting me and saying, can I use your course to teach my curriculum? So I've had school districts ask me to use it. I've had choirs all around the world. I've had voice teachers all around the world. And then I've also had a lot of other singers and alumni, people that are saying, I bought your course and it is so fun. And thank you for reminding me that singing is fun. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to brush up my skills. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I'm finding all of my students are asking for and struggling with is there's no structure. And sort of we've lost our goals. We've lost our structure in the arts in a way that can be inspiring, but also can be overwhelming. And so this course is providing structure. And cohorts are popping up all over the world, which is so fun. So people are doing it together. So they're all like, oh, let's do, there are 24 weeks. And so they're doing the course together where they're in groups and they're saying, let's all do this lesson together. So it's really fun.
Are the sessions that you've created improv'd or are they scripted?
You know, that's a good question. So Michael studied with me, so he knows. My philosophy is of teaching is very much to teach to the individual. I really believe that every voice is authentic and unique. And, you know, the minute I heard your voice, Michael, on your intro, I was like, Michael, I love it, because I know your voice by how it sounds. That's how we know the
voice. Do you have any notes?
We love, right? No, it's wonderful. And so that's my goal in life. So to create content that is for everyone, it was just so counterintuitive for me in the beginning. But then I realized there's so much vocabulary that we have together. And so when we were in the filming process, everything was scripted. And when I started to deliver the content in the practice sessions that we had, the producers came to me and said, can you just do that improvised? Because we know that that's how you normally work. Hmm. So we'll let you go off script. Let's just see what happens. And then they said, okay, that was magical. And we want that. We want to capture that. But that's not how they work. That's not how the structure of great courses works. So what they did is they created something. They actually made, we had t-shirts that said this by the end of the process, that said, Pierce going rogue. and that's what they called it. And so I would be on script until I felt like I really needed to go off script to really deliver the content well. And so that it's both. It's scripted and it's improvised. And it's really awesome how they were able to follow it back and forth, and they got really good at following where I was, and they could catch me. Oh, she's coming back. Here she's coming. Back to the script.
It sounds amazing, and I can't wait to take my course because I'm doing it soon. And it sounds like with the holidays, it sounds like it's a perfect gift idea. You want to support or wants to get back into voice lessons. How can we get a class from you?
Yeah, well, you know, what's really fun, there's a free class actually on YouTube that's posted. So if you search for The Great Courses, How to Sing, there is a class on cervical spine posture. I actually just learned that today when I was searching for something, and I was like, oh, it's there for free, which is great. So everyone can access that class. And the course can be purchased at greatcourses.com or greatcoursesplus.com. They have gift certificates coming out, I'm told, in November that people can purchase. So if they want to get the course for someone else, that's really fun. And there's actually, they have a sale going on right now. So you can get 24 lessons for under $100, which is crazy. And awesome. And so I think that it's a great gift for the holidays and things coming up, and also a good resource if you have people in your community that are struggling, or, you know, music schools, or your, even if it's your elementary school or your junior high that's really struggling and the teachers are like, what do we do? Just tell them about the course, have them contact me and reach out to me. The Great Courses has been so generous in the ways that they're supporting communities, and they're giving group licenses and things like that. So this can be used in so many different ways.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming on here. I'm definitely going to check out some of those videos.
Awesome. I hope you do. And let me know how it goes. There's an Ithaca College, a musical theater alumna that is featured in the film. I have students of all levels and all ages, and one of them is from the program that you did, Michael. So.
It's so good to see you, and I'm so thankful that you came on, because, you know, we have to keep learning, we have to adjust, and if we're going to take classes and voice on the computer and remotely, then we got to do it. So thank you for being a resource, and I can't wait for people to be doing this.
Thank you, and thanks for having me. It was nice to meet you, Brian, and good to see you, Michael.
Nice to meet you. Bye. All right. And as a reminder,
yay. Okay, my friends.
Sorry.
I think I'm having,
you're cutting in. Oh, there we go. You're cutting in and out. So that's why. Okay. I'm just going to keep going. As a reminder, we're announcing a special partnership with Broadway for Biden for the month of October on My Broadway Memory. So stay tuned for our slew of guests that's coming up for October. We're really pushing for voter registration, which was this past Tuesday. But still, you can keep registering to vote. Every week for the month of October, we'll be encouraging listeners to get out and vote, or vote by mail on November 3rd. We'll continue to have amazing Broadway guests, share amazing stories, and get you out to vote. If you did just get here, or... Sorry,
something's
Michael.
Happening with my Wi-Fi. No, it's okay. Something's happening with my Wi-Fi. It's totally cool. Yeah. Am I back? Am I okay?
You're back. You're back. I can hear you.
Okay, great.
So if you did just get here, if you did just get here or have been here, please comment below and make yourself known. We love hearing from you guys and from people that are watching. So feel free to be a part of the conversation. Michael, before we continue with Jackie's memory, what do you say we do a Q&A? Let's get Mary and Jackie back on here.
I would love that. I would love that.
Oh, with a new situation on Mary's end.
I turned my thing around and this is better.
It's beautiful.
That's beautiful. I love it. Everyone looks fabulous and I'm so glad to see you guys again. Thank you for coming back. I hope you found your equity caught.
Yeah.
I didn't, but it's okay.
We'll complain. We'll call Amazon.
Okay, good. So this first question is for Mary from Stoyle98 on our Instagram page.
Oh my God. I thought that was Stoli, like the vodka.
Honestly, I would have loved that, but it's Stoyle.
It's so, like Stoyle98. They're like 21.
Foiled by Stoyle. So describe working with Bill Finn.
Well, I've known Bill since I'm 19 years old. So working with him is frustrating sometimes because it can be a pain in the ass, but I love him. And, you know, he's like family to me. So it's like working with your brother, kind of. I want you to ask Jackie about her transport group show.
Okay. Well, the thing is we like Jack. I mean,
I'm not a host.
We're gonna circle back. We're gonna have to circle back to that upon your request.
This is the transition part. This is now when we hand it over to Jackie because we want to be able to feature both of you. You guys have so many stories that it's like.
We do have a question for Jackie from Sarah on Facebook, and this is about the Jersey. I'm sorry. This is about the Adams
family. Jersey boy.
I was going to say the Jersey family.
I thought you were Frankie Valli, but
the Adams family, how fast did you get your makeup on? You had quite an extensive.
That's funny that she asked that because I would like to say it took a long time to get that ugly, but it took about 5 minutes. And I still have the it's a Ben Nye palette, and it literally is called Old Character. Never throwing it away.
And you had prosthetics too, right?
Perfect.
I had moles. Yeah.
Moles.
Good. I love that so much. Old character. Ooh, and this
character lady.
And this question is for both of you from Alana in Canada, from our Instagram page. How hard was it to keep a straight face working with each other during Xanadu?
Oh, God.
You know, we are the kind of performers that don't break unless it serves us.
Or unless we can't help it.
Yeah.
She's a rock. She'd always, I gotta be on the bus. I don't know what this one's gonna do. She would always say that, but we couldn't break her. I don't think I ever broke her.
No, because I don't really break, but
she doesn't.
In the two of us, I always gave Jackie, I never tried to compete with Jackie with ad-libs because Jackie is a genius. So I would just let Jackie go. And occasionally I would respond, Jackie, remember the night I pull all your candles out. Do you remember that?
Yes, I brought a menorah on stage. Yeah. She blew out my candles.
I took all the candles out. But at the closing of Xanadu, Jackie did like 20 minutes on West Side Story numbers. Do you remember, Jax?
Yes.
And I just really basically just walked off stage. I just said, I just walked off stage. You got to give it to Jackie. You cannot compete. You just have to let Jackie go.
Wow. Yeah, but the way Mary Testa walks off stage, it actually was competition. Grand gesture.
Jackie, do you have anybody that you feel that way about being on stage with?
Oh, God. Nathan, of course, could always kill me.
Wow. That's I love that.
It's a recipe.
Robbie says, I saw Xanadu over 50 times, and every time I laughed at 50. Every time, wow, 50 times they broke
the
cast.
Robbie!
Hi, Robbie.
Is it Wonder Robbie?
Yes.
Oh my God! Yes. Wow. Yay. Blast from the past.
He was one of the Xanadus.
Wow.
Xanadu.
Xanadus. That's good.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Did you have Adam's Family fans? Did you have names for Adam's Family fans? Adam's families?
The ancestors.
What did you say?
Desperate people.
God damn it. I'm
Adam's Fansley, I guess.
Adam's Fansleys. Now, Jackie's
got some playbills.
Would you like to share a Broadway memory?
I will show several Broadway memories. Well, I just wanted to show people die in my building a lot. And one night I found a huge stack of playbills from someone who saw everything. And I'll just show you a few choices. Let me see if I can get this angle right.
Was it Irene Ryan?
It wasn't Irene Ryan. This is the playbill for My Fair Lady. Julie Andrews, My Fair Lady. Look how different that is. There's not the yellow banner.
Didn't even have colored printers.
Here's West Side Story. Wow.
And they look like really good condition.
Larry Kurt. Yeah. Oh, he should rest in peace. They are all in mint condition. And in the back are all cigarette ads. Everyone has a ton of cigarette ads. Oh my God. TWA and Pan Am ads. Here's Angela Lansbury, MAME. And look, I said I didn't save the playbill from anything I saw, but I was wrong because I saw a little show. Now, I actually was not only in it, I saw it. And this black and white playbill version, which was not the usual playbill, that's because when Broadway producers are running out of money, one of the ways they cut corners is they do the playbill in black and white. So Xanadu was losing money, and that's when they decided to make money and replace me notoriously with Whoopi Goldberg. So to prove I wasn't the bitter old cow that I was, I saw the show with Whoopi Goldberg.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
And coming down the steps from the bathroom, some woman was yelling at me, "Excuse me." I said, "I was in this show." Now I'm using the regular bathroom.
But Jackie was paid.
I was planning my wedding at the time, and I didn't give a shit about my wedding. I just gave a shit about Xanadu because I loved it so much. And so I made the theme, the place cards and all the at the tables said Xanidu. And when the producer took me out for a beverage and told me he was replacing me, the first thing I said was, "But my place cards say Xanidu."
Oh my God.
But I did
get paid. It was only a month.
And I found, when I was looking through this playbill today, I found a card. There was a goodbye card that I saved that everybody signed.
Wrote
messages.
Yeah.
But yes, so they made money and they made a killing because Whoopi filled the theater. And then I came back and they closed. I closed it.
Yeah. A show killer.
With my no name ass, I closed it.
Please, no, Jackie. You're a genius.
Genius doesn't sell, baby.
Well, and an Emmy nominee for your incredible work in Feud.
That's all right. Look, all this is so sad. Everybody's trying to make. No, it's okay.
No, that was an amazing performance. That was great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I mean, the two of you, it's like, you know, I as soon as we had you guys solidified for the show, you both are geniuses. You're
legendary.
Legendary people.
Oh,
I don't...
that's so nice of you to say. I'm so itchy tonight.
It's okay. It might be my compliments, and it's okay.
I think
I'll stop.
My skin is dry.
So you guys want to play a game?
Yes.
Sure.
Let's play a game.
It's a dangerous game.
That's Jekyll and Hyde.
Oh, my Lord.
What was that from?
That's Jekyll and Hyde.
Ah.
Which I love.
They had a bunch of groupies. I remember seeing some of Jackies or something.
Jackies.
If I saw it a lot of times, I'd be Jackie the Jackie.
Yeah.
That's how my relatives in Israel, that's how they say my name. Jackie.
Jackie. That's funny. That's very funny.
Oh, look, you can see a little faint version of the color playbill of Xanadu in the background.
There you go.
So this game is called Blurt the Blur. And I mean, we kind of have fun with this. This is how it works. We show like a screen is going to come up with a blurred version, and then you're going to have to figure out what it's from, and then we unblur it and you see if you were right. Oh, but if you really don't know what it is, make a like a really funny guess, like the funniest thing you could think of to.
I'm going to have to get like this close to do this.
Okay. I know Michael did say this morning, you know, that I made them too small last time. So I tried going a little bigger. Okay. First one. Who wants to go first?
Ragtime.
Crazy for You?
Michael. Follies.
Sideshow.
Sideshow. Wow. Oh, the revival with Emily Padgett.
Yes.
Yeah, that I saw.
I don't know these guys, just letting you know. Brian comes up with the game, so I'm
very good.
Wow, she got it. Wow, good one, Mary.
Thanks.
Saigon. What? Sorry.
Yes, because it's Army Green. I'm gonna suck at this game. I'm visually impaired.
Brian, you're doing all the revivals.
It's hard to find older pictures in quick Google searches.
there's Assassins? Levels.
You mentioned this before, Mary. You guessed this on the first one.
I did. What did I say on the first one? Ragtime.
Ragtime. The revival.
Is that the Henry Ford thing?
It had the same sort of set for Assassins.
It's a pretty cool set.
Yeah.
It's a revival, okay? That's your hint.
I just don't know what that is.
Company? I don't know.
Yes.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah, he got one.
I can't believe I got one.
This is an original.
West Side Story? No.
Trip of Love.
Think about the flags in the background.
Flags? Evita?
Jeffy.
Oh, yes.
I never saw it, so I wouldn't even.
Neither did I.
Yeah.
That's the original.
Oh, wow. That's a lot of blue on the town. We had all these blue LED lights.
I don't know.
Beautiful set. Is that Anastasia?
I saw Anastasia. The projections were fantastic.
Bonnie and Clyde.
Yes. Very good.
It is?
Good for you.
Jack.
This is like, you kids won't remember, but when you'd watch porn on cable in the early 90s, this is how it came in.
Out what was happening. Passion? No, it's not Passion.
Oh, I know what this is, but I'll let you guess. This is Adam's Family with the gentleman on the left, Luke.
You are breaking up.
You did Adam's Family. He said you did Adam's Family with the gentleman on the
with
left.
The gentleman on the left. Is it Nathan? Funny thing happened on the way to the forum?
No.
No. SpongeBob.
SpongeBob.
Wes Taylor. Oh my God, that looks amazing.
Yeah.
Plankton.
The girl.
Sorry.
Steph Shue.
It's
Steph Shue.
Oh, okay.
And our last one for the evening.
Moulin Rouge.
That's a good guess.
The Taj? Taj? No.
Oh,
Mormon. Oh, my God.
I didn't want to go classic with the white tie. And, there
that
you
was,
go.
That was hard.
Thanks.
Hard. That was.
I know. I never know what's difficult and what's not for everyone.
Each got a couple of them.
Yeah. Yeah. And I love Michael that you play along too.
Yeah.
Brittany gets SpongeBob.
Yes, Brittany gets SpongeBob from the back from backstage.
Yes. My friends, we're wrapping up episode, but I don't know if you want to share anything. Is there any place that you're coming up virtually? Any other appearances that you're making that you would like to plug?
Mary.
No, I have nothing. Well, I'm going to do some readings, in some new reading festival that's going to benefit the Actors Fund.
Great.
I want you to ask Jackie.
Oh, let's circle back. Yes, this is the perfect time to circle back.
Because it was the first time Jackie got to play the romantic lead.
Okay, the transport group, Jackie Hoffman. Here we go.
Oh, thanks, Mary.
You're welcome.
Well, what can I say? It was a fun tour de force and a just, you know, like Mary had in Queen of the Mist, it was a chance to choose scenery and
what show is this?
Use my whole shtick, Once Upon a Mattress.
Oh.
I played Princess Winifred, not the queen, the princess.
Mm-hmm. You see, Jackie and I are always cast as the characters or the second bananas. And when we get a chance to play the lead, we are pretty damn good. And so it's really lovely.
And grateful.
Yeah. And grateful.
Yes, and we managed to be, well, I won't, it's a G-rated show, but we managed to be attractive, sexy, and funny. Yeah.
Well, do you guys have any of those roles that you don't necessarily always get to typically go out for that you would just die to chew the scenery?
Yeah. Well, what? I've said this in many interviews, but the one role, I do a lot of new stuff and I like doing new stuff. I've done revivals, but I like doing new stuff. But the one role I've always wanted to play is Kate in Taming of the Shrew. Always.
Similarly, I'd like to play Martha in Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf.
Mm. Yeah.
Musical.
The musical.
Exclamation point at the end.
It's just Virginia.
at the Virginia
Theater. Anyone else I want to say who's ever watching? Michael is a wonderful photographer, and I had the best time because I think headshots are really hard, and I had the best time, and it was easy and fun and great, and so everybody should book with Michael.
Oh, well, I can't wait to get in the studio with Michael.
Michael, you're totally thank you. That's very and frozen and everything.
Now, the photo that we used for promo for this, Michael, was that one of the ones that you took?
Is that better?
Yes.
Yeah, oh, okay. It was beautiful. The
yes.
Black and white photo, that
yes.
was great.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, they came
so
out great.
Speaking of, I have my bike in here because I was cleaning in the other, but speaking of transport, this is a picture, I photographed the Playbill for Molly Brown revival and with Beth Malone at Transport, and this is an outtake, and I loved it so much that I got it blown up in the studio.
It's gorgeous.
Thanks, it's but gorgeous. Mary, you... Having you in the studio is it's amazing. I mean, like, I've been dying to work with you for, you know, ever since I was, ever since I discovered you and your genius. And so having you in the studio is it's something I'll never forget. And I'm really
very
glad
nice.
To have to collaborate.
That's very nice. Well, it was easy and nice and wonderful. So I tell everybody that, you know, you should book with him because it's great shots, too. I love my shots.
Yeah.
Jackie, have you taken with him? Jackie.
Huh? What?
Have you taken any pictures with Michael?
Michael photographed us in our dressing room in Yiddish Fiddler, right?
Ah, yeah.
Which, let's talk about Yiddish.
He was a delightful guest. We didn't want him to leave.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Yiddish Fiddler for a
oh,
second.
Oh, such a beautiful, talk about a good revival.
I loved it so much. It was so great.
I spent backstage twice. One for, I was shooting for, I think, Broadway Cares, and then I did Dressing Room Project. And the feel of backstage, it felt like you were mishpucha.
Right?
Yes, it felt like you were family.
Uh-huh,
and
yes.
And it so translated beautifully on stage. It was such an amazing production. And
it's
sort of like what we were talking about, Within the Heights, where it's sort of like, maybe we're not sure of what we're hearing or what's going
100%.
On. 100%. We know the story from start to finish.
I'm going to be honest. It was the first time. So my boyfriend, Stan, was the A2 on the production. And so I went to when you guys were closing downtown at the
museum.
And I have to say, I didn't know Fiddler at all. I had never seen it before. And seeing it for the first time that way, I'm almost really happy that that was the first experience I had seeing it, because I wasn't even fully understanding all of word for word what was being said, but just the images, the pictures on stage and the, you know, the human relationships were coming across that I fully understood what was going on and found it beautiful in many different ways.
It was a gorgeous production. I saw the opening night on off Broadway, and it was a spectacular production.
Yeah.
Spectacular. Yeah.
Absolutely amazing. Do you, Jackie, do you have like a fond memory that you want to share with it, or
I mean, the whole thing was a fond memory. It was very meaningful and very attached to my heritage and to my mother, who I lost this year. So the whole thing was a very emotional, hate this word, journey.
Mm. Did your mom get to see it?
She did, and it was one of the last thrills of her life. She just loved it. She loved it. Mm. That was heaven for her. If she was going to go out on one job that I have, that was it.
Aww.
That's great.
Charlotte. That's beautiful and amazing, and Bichert, right? It's Bichert.
It's Bichert. And stuff would happen when we were in that museum, because it had a really sweet theater, but they weren't really meant to be doing theater. So, like, we would be, tradition, this is a fire drill. This is a fire. Unprofessional, waiting for Guffman, amateur stuff would happen all the time. You know, homeless people banging on the door backstage trying to get in. It was just kind of crazy.
I love it. I love that.
That's amazing. Do you know, Jackie, and Mary, do you know the show? There's a show called A Stoop on Orchard Street, and it was a musical in 2000, 2002 that was off Broadway at the Mazur Theater, and it was like Fiddler on the Roof Part 2. It was like 1901. I think the year was 1901.
Oh, wow. 1902.
And it was like after everyone left the shtetls, they landed on the Lower East Side, and it was a show called A Stoop on Orchard Street.
Wow. Was it the same creative team?
No.
Who was in it? Who directed it? Who wrote it?
It was Lon Gary, Jay Colas. There's a cast album out there. Wow. And I'm trying to think, Marla Mandel was in it at one point. There's a few people that were
that name.
That were, you know, I think it was it ran Non-Equity downtown for like 2 years.
Lon Gary, Joel Halstead, Joseph Spiata, Stuart Marshall.
Yes. And I don't
know any of these.
Scott
people,
Wagner.
That's wonderful. That's so great.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And you know, all the blue haired people came and saw
the show. They must have loved it.
The matinees, I'm sure, were sold out beyond belief. But
how long did it run?
I think about 2.5 years.
Wow.
Oh.
I mean, I'd never heard of it.
Yeah. With all the Fiddler trivia we kept hearing.
I know, right?
Stoop on Orchard Street.
A Stoop on Orchard Street.
Love it. Where can we find you guys on the social media? I know we were talking about this a little before we started.
Their handles are right there.
Their handles. I know, but we were talking about they're specifically on certain places.
There are.
I'm on Facebook,
like Jackie,
Instagram.
You're on Twitter.
I'm on the Twitter.
Yeah,
Twitter.
I'm on Twitter.
Awesome. Great.
And I have the dream role of a lifetime. Next week on Andy Cohn's Radio Theater, I'll be playing a Real Housewife. We do a reading of the Real Housewife script.
Oh, I love that.
That should be very exciting. I don't know. I haven't gotten the sides yet, but you can't go wrong. I'll play any housewife anytime.
That's so great. Oh, that'll be great.
That's going to be so good. And so we'll catch you doing that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'll be, you know, by the river.
Oh, my.
I'll be right behind you.
I'll be by the river.
If you thought you enjoyed Xanadu on land, where do you see it underwater?
Not with roller skates, but with swimmies. So
exactly. Scuba gear.
We're going to move on to our closing segment, but you guys have been amazing, 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 and brilliant, and I'm so honored to have you on the show, and thank you for sharing your stories with us.
Thank you for having us. Thank you so much. This was lovely.
Good. I hope you had fun, and I can't wait to talk to you guys soon.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, guys. Bye.
Michael, I have to be honest. I almost forgot about this segment.
No, I know. Well, we're introducing it. It's new. It's an out-of-town tryout, right? So we can't forget about it because we got to do it.
So, you take it away. Take it away.
Okay. So, this is our new segment, and it's time for
Throwback Thursday.
Throwback Thursday.
We find a way back to then.
With new graphics, huh? How's that? Mm-hmm. Oh, wait. Since I moved my computer, I forgot to bring the Playbill with me. So, because we have such an amazing mix of viewers, we have people that have seen shows in the Golden Age or theater historians or people that love contemporary musicals. I mean, really, it's a mixed bag every single episode. We wanted to make sure that we were really keeping Broadway alive. That's our whole idea of the show, is keeping Broadway alive. So I decided, I got a whole, I got like 150 old playbills of shows that I had never even heard of, or I heard in passing, they ran for a week or whatever. But I've been loving going through them. I got them from a family I know, the Steinberg family. And what we're going to do every week is go through one of them together, because they are, they represent a part of the theater that does not exist anymore. So this is Same Time Next Year, which played at the Brooks Atkinson. And it was at the time of it running on Broadway, Absurd Person Singular, Candide, Dance With Me, Equus, Godspell, Good Time Charlie, Grease, the original production of Grease, Pippin, Raisin, same time next year, Shenandoah, Sherlock Holmes, The Hot L Baltimore, Magic Show, and The Wiz was playing on Broadway. This
I just want to walk down the street at that time, you know, and just look at the marquees.
But look at the cigarette ads.
Oh, I know, like anything before 2000.
Don't smoke, but look at the cigarette ad. It starred Ellen Burstyn and Charles Grodin. So this is, and basically it was a show about a married couple that was not married to each other, but they met in a motel once a year. And the show follows them through 25 years. We see them in 1951, 1956, 61, 65, 70, and 75. And this was in May of 1975 when this playbill was printed and seen by the world.
And that was before they had websites, so the little www.playbill.com is not on the bottom.
Brian, what an astute observation.
I'm all about the appearance.
Yeah, no Instagram, so there was no verified show account. There was none of that. So awesome. With that, yeah, that was Throwback Thursday.
Woo! Love yes. it.
So now you guys know about Same Time Next Year.
Thank you. So that was so much fun and informative, but unfortunately we have to go, but we're going to be back same time next week, Thursday at 7, same time, same place for more Broadway memories.
Yes, yes, yes. Please keep in touch with us by following us on social media at My Broadway Memory on Instagram, and Facebook is My B-Way Memory. My Broadway Memory on Instagram and Facebook, and at my B-Way Memory on Twitter. Please repost, retweet, redo whatever you kids do. And you can always reach out to Brian and I. We're really good at replying.
Yes. And we're so excited to see you next week, where we're going to start our amazing Broadway for Biden episodes on Monday on Instagram. We will announce our guests for next week.
Yes, yeah, seriously, these episodes are going to be amazing. So tune in. Every Thursday, 7 p.m. live. And as always, thank you to our amazing team at Broadway Podcast Network, Alan, Dory, Brittany, Katie. Thank you so much.
You guys are amazing. Thank you all. Have a great week, everybody.
Have a great week.